you need to learn how to bicycle. It's not an easy task because you have to be continuously stabilizing it. And it is not statically stable in the sense that if the moment you stop pedaling, it'll tilt or fall. So static stability is something which it is good if you can build into the aircraft so that the pilot, for most of the time, the pilot can be relieved of the tedium. Okay, so we'll proceed further in this the next session of the equilibrium. So. Okay, sorry about that. So that was a slide I had used in your seniors class when the whole thing had to be again as now done through online. So I had done an audio recording as an experiment. So that's what you heard. So that was for the whole thing. So I was not speaking. It was in the slide, audio in the slide. So that is it. I don't bother about that. So what we'll do now, we'll continue. And in the initial part, we talked about performance of the aircrafts. So performance topics deal with forces and translational motion needed to fulfill the aircraft mission. So you want to, when you say performance, you talk about level flight, you talk about rate of climb, you talk about turn rates, you talk about takeoff and landing and all that. So they're all the performance topics. So stability and control topics deal with movements and rotational motion. So performance is largely forces and translational motion, largely. For example, turn rate, you also have moments coming there. Stability and control, the topics deal with moments and rotational motion needed for the aircraft to remain controllable. Again, to summarize the picture, you have, if you look at the aircraft from the front, if one side aileron goes down, the other side goes up, there is a difference in the lift being produced from that side of the aircraft. So there is a rolling motion here. And similarly, if I deflect elevator here on the bottom figure, you will have a nose up moment. So if I deflect the elevator up, what actually happens is I'm reducing the lift being produced, increasing the lift retained because the camber increases, and then you have a nose up moment. Okay, similarly for the rudder. So an aircraft in flight is completely unconstrained and 6 degrees of freedom, 3 in translation and 3 rotational ones. Okay, so this means there are many ways for instability to appear, and due to high speed of the aircraft, the instability can have serious consequences. For example, if you're bicycling and your bicycle goes into instability mode, at best you will fall down and maybe scratch yourself up, or at the worst case, break a bone. There is no life-threatening event. Whereas in an aircraft, if it gets stability and the pilot is not able to control, it leads to crash and usually a loss of life. Okay. Recently, for example, you must have read about a MiG-29 aircraft which took off from the ship and crashed. This happened, I think, last week. There was a wreck, and I think wreck has been located. So instability in an aircraft leads to normally a catastrophic event. So while stability has multiple facets, we'll first start with what is called static stability. That's the weaker form of stability, where, you know, when the aircraft is in equilibrium, a small disturbance like a gust or something, and the aircraft returns back to its equilibrium condition. There was a noise. I was wondering if somebody was waiting in the lobby or something. No, it's not. So let's continue. So static stability, you can look at it as a weaker form of stability. You really have to do the dynamic stability eventually for it to be able to do that. So as before, a body said to be statically stable if a disturbance generates a force or moment as appropriate, which tends to restore the body to initial stage. So the generation of a restoring force and moment should be built into the aircraft. It's without the pilot action, without the pilot doing anything. Okay, now that is what's called static stability. And this is ensured by what's called a stability margin, where you ensure that the center of pressure or the point where the force acts, the lift force acts, is behind the center of gravity. And what are the conditions and all that are part of this course. We will derive all those conditions later. The key point and also restoring moment, which tends to bring the body back to its equilibrium state. In an aircraft, the stability could be different types of stability. The stability could be, for example, velocity, that the pilot has set the aircraft at Mach 0.7 for cruise conditions, and something happens, let's say the thrust increases or the drag increases, and the velocity changes, and it should go back to whatever the velocity the pilot has set. So it could be the velocity, it could be heading, it could be angle of attack, any one of this. So when there is a slight disturbance from that condition without any efforts on the part of the pilot, it comes back to stable its equilibrium. Of course, it's possible that an aircraft may be stable under some conditions of flight and unstable in other conditions of flight. As I said, there are cases where the aircraft is stable in the longitudinal dynamics, but it may be unstable in the lateral or directional, in which case you have to also limit the angle of attack in the pitch direction. So this is almost every fighter airplane has this issue. So there are limiters put there. So even while longitudinally it may be stable, there may be issues with directional and lateral. So you may not be, the pilot may not be allowed to fly at that angle of attack. Okay, so in some conditions it may be unstable. So we'll have to check all the conditions if you're designing an aircraft. So when you say control authority or control power, is the force which the pilot can generate by deflecting any of the control surfaces to maneuver the aircraft into a desired position. As I said, equilibrium is when all the forces and moments balance out. When the pilot wants to move from one equilibrium state to another, meaning that let's say he has been cruising for so long and it is now time to initiate the landing procedure, in which case he has to reduce the velocity from cruise Mach number to a lower Mach number, also point the nose downwards so that he starts gliding towards the landing. So essentially the pilot is trying to move from one equilibrium state to another, and this is what is called control. Okay, so this, and when he, if he has to do that, then he should have the ability to generate the necessary force and moment to disturb from one equilibrium state to another equilibrium state, and then ensure that it is stable there. So as stated earlier, an aircraft, when disturbed not by the pilot, by some external issues like sudden air pockets or gusts, then of course if it returns to its own original equilibrium, that's stability. When the pilot wants, that's a different issue. On the other hand, let's say if the airplane tends to move further away from the position it was because of some disturbance, not when the pilot is doing anything, the pilot is with the hands off, and there is a gust and the aircraft pitches up, but it continues to pitch up and shows no intention or no restoring force or moment to bring it back to equilibrium, then it is called unstable. In some cases, some odd cases, it's possible that there is no restoring moment, or there is no moment to increase the stability. So basically, nothing happens. So this is where, when the aircraft is disturbed, let's say the pitch angle is increased by 1 degree, it stays there. It neither increases the pitch angle nor restores back to the equilibrium position. So meaning that there is no restoring force at all. It's just like a ball on a horizontal surface. You push the ball, it stays wherever it is. If it's on a convex surface, then you push the ball, it will fall off into another place. If it's a concave surface, you push the ball, it will again roll back to its original state after a couple of oscillations. Stabilizes in wherever it is. Position where there is neither a diverging force nor a restoring force at moment is called neutral stability. And sometimes this is also a desirable future. Not always, but in some odd cases, it may be a desirable future to have. And aircraft stability, an aircraft can be statically stable to small changes in the incidence. For example, if it's cruising at an angle of attack of 2 degrees and the gust pushes it to 4 degrees or pushes it down to zero, then it can may come back to its original 2 degrees angle of attack after a few oscillations. Okay, but if the from 2 degrees it's suddenly pushed up to 18 degrees by a massive gust or what's called a clear air turbulence, which happens in atmosphere, then the aircraft may not be stable anymore. Okay, so it can be stable for small changes of incidence, but unstable for large changes. For example, if the change pushes the wing beyond its stall angle, then of course it will not come back to its equilibrium. The restoring factor is usually a moment, so that the quantity is a rate of change of moment with displacement. Okay, and this is equivalent to some kind of stiffness. Okay, for example, you must have seen doors which have a damper. Those doors, if you open them slowly, they will open. You try to pull them open fast, they will resist. So that's some kind of damping and stiffness. And stiffness also is related to the spring kind of action. So the larger the force you apply, the more is the resistance. So this kind of restoring force can also look at it as a stiffness. Not in the traditional strength of materials definition, but it's equivalent definition. And any change in one state to another, equilibrium state to another, is affected by using the control surfaces. The challenge is there are only 3 control surfaces and 1 control in thrust, but there are 6 degrees of motion. Okay, so when the pilot moves the control surface, while it generates the restoring moment, but there is a resistance to it too. It's like, when your car is traveling forward, it's difficult to open the door because there is the wind force will try to close it down. Right? So that's the restoring or the moments, and they are resisted. And a large aircraft like a Boeing 737 or an Airbus 380, the force needed to move the elevator or rudder is so large that it's humanly impossible. So the pilot's action is amplified through, initially it used to be through hydraulics, jacks, and nowadays it's the pilot only moves the control surface. Just electronically, whatever he wants to do is sensed, and the actuators, which are right close to the control surfaces, they move the control surface. The pilot doesn't need to apply the force himself. The earlier aircraft, the control surfaces were connected through cables, steel cables, to the pilot's control surfaces. So if you wanted to do a nose-up maneuver, then he had to pull the control stick towards him and by a certain amount of force, and that would move the elevator. With small aircraft, this is okay. The pilot could exert the force. As the aircraft became bigger and bigger, the force needed, or the stick force as we'll calculate later, the stick force needed for maneuver became very, very high, and the pilot couldn't achieve that. So that's when they had to do other ways to implement that. So summarizing, we have already gone through this. Next important part we need to look at is what's called the trim condition. Okay. Trim condition is when the pilot has set the direction, altitude, and the velocity in which he wants to continue. Okay, but the forces and movements are not cancelled out yet. He has achieved what he wants to do in terms of status, in, meaning the velocity and the altitude and the heading. And he wants to continue in this flight for, let's say, 40 minutes or 1 hour or whatever time. But are not cancelled out. So in a normal flight, it's usual for the pilot to adjust the controls of an aircraft such that on releasing the controls, it continues to fly at the chosen flight. So he has to adjust the moments and the forces so that the net summation of moments and forces at the center of gravity are zero at that state wherever he wants it to be. So by this means, you know, the pilot is relieved of the tedium. So if he is able to trim the aircraft, and then he can take his hands off for some time without bothering to continuously monitor the aircraft's either altitude or heading or the velocity at which it's flying. So in such a case, the aircraft is said to be trimmed, and the trim state defines the initial conditions about which the dynamics of interest may be studied. So first we have to find out what is the trim condition of the aircraft, meaning that if it's flying at 11 kilometers altitude or 0.8 Mach number velocity, then what should be the elevator angle or what should be the angle of attack of the wing and what should be the rudder condition for it to remain in equilibrium, meaning to balance out all the forces and movements. Okay, now the forces generated by both wing and the elevator depend like velocity square. Okay, if the velocity reduces for some reason, then the forces go down more drastically because they depend on velocity square. So just for the sake of clarity, let's say the velocity suddenly becomes half of what the pilot wanted it to do. If that happens, the lift goes down by a factor of 2, 4, because it's a square, and the trailing lift being produced by the horizontal tail at the back also goes by down by a factor of 4. So that's the challenge when the forces depend on that. And the moment, of course, depends on the force and the momentum. Momentum doesn't change. But it's only the force which can have a very serious effect on trim and the flight conditions. And all aircraft are equipped with by means of presetting or adjusting the datum or trim setting by the primary control surfaces. So the elevator itself is a huge surface, and it's difficult for the pilot to move the elevator by small angles of when he's trimming it. So instead, what is done, the elevator itself has a smaller part attached to it, which is called the tab, trim tab, movable tab. So the pilot uses the small tab for fine corrections when he's trying to trim the aircraft. So when he's, of course, trying to take off from the runway or land towards the runway or start the initiate rate of climb, then he'll deflect the main elevator. But once he has reached the position in which he wants to be, for minor adjustments, small corrections, he uses what's called a trim tab. And these trim tabs are fixed on almost all the control surfaces, largely in the elevator. So it will be a small part of the elevator which he will move in corrections. It's like, you know, in a radio, I don't know if you guys have seen a radio at all. In a radio, there used to be something called bands. Okay, and in that you select the band and then the frequency you adjust by small tuner. Okay, so in the moment, let's say you say in an FM, you're looking at 90 gigahertz band or 100 megahertz band or 200 megahertz band. You choose the band and then from there, so 91.1 and all, you do with a small tuner. So the tuner is what is an elevator trap. So it will produce small forces and small movements just to trim the aircraft. For large forces and large movements, the pilot has to deflect the main surface itself. Okay, so almost all aircraft have, you know, this continuously adjustable elevated trim tab, except for very, very small ones like Pushpak or Tiger Moth or small little aircraft, where the pilot himself moves the elevator fully without any issues. All other aircrafts, the bigger ones, have a trim tab, which the pilot adjusts. So of course, once the pilot sets it into a position, whichever he wants, then only you have to look at the stability part of it. Once it is trimmed, then we have to study the. Hey, somebody's microphone is on and I hear some other voices. Okay, these things happen in online class, I guess. So we have to study the stability of an aircraft after the aircraft has achieved trim condition. Okay, there's no point studying it before that. Okay, so that's the thing. So when you say the aircraft is trimmed, then the forces and moments about all the three axes should be zero. Only then the aircraft is trimmed. So thus the trimming is concerned with the controlled actions required to establish equilibrium with the characteristics required to ensure that the aircraft remains in equilibrium. So as I said, the object of trimming is to bring the forces and moments acting on the aircraft into a state of equilibrium. Once this is done, then if there is a disturbance on top of this, we are interested in how the aircraft responds to that. So that's the part of the stability condition. So there are three normal forces and three moments, like the pitch, roll, and yaw. The force balance is often expressed as lift is equal to weight and thrust is equal to drag. And this is also used extensively in performance studies, wherever you're looking at trying to look at the performance. It's thrust equal to drag, lift equal to weight in a steady level flight. So summarizing, achieving equilibrium trim is about balancing forces and moments so that they cancel out. Aircraft have control surfaces in order to alter forces and moments to achieve the trim condition. Moments are taken with respect to aerodynamic center, as moments do not change with angle of attack with aerodynamic center. At least in subsonic flows, they don't change. Whereas center pressure moves with the change in angle of attack. So you always try to transpose all the forces and moments with respect to aerodynamic center and with respect to center of gravity. So that's the condition we are looking at. A system is in equilibrium if some of all the forces are, these are all summarized slides. So a system is dynamically stable if given enough time, it actually returns to the equilibrium position. Given enough time is a qualifier, and there are possibilities that the aircraft needs to return to its equilibrium with a much, much faster rate than necessary. That depends on the status of that. If, for example, there is a pitch oscillation and the aircraft is close to the ground, then that is catastrophic. If the pitch oscillation is when the aircraft is at 8 kilometers altitude, then there is enough time for the aircraft to come back to its equilibrium position without causing any undue catastrophic event. So an aircraft can be statically stable to small changes in incident, but unstable for large changes. We have to take that into account. And stability doesn't mean it's stable for all conditions. That's not true. It's also possible that stability in one axis, like the yaw and roll axis, can affect the overall flight envelope, even while the longitudinal stability is available. So that thing's also there. All the aircraft loads can be considered to act through a point at which the aerodynamic moments are zero. This is the called the center of pressure. And this, of course, will change with angle of attack. Aerodynamic center is defined as the location at which the pitching moment is unaffected by angle of attack. So for forces, you look at center of pressure. For moments, you look at aerodynamic center. However, the wing, the weight of the aircraft, the structural weight of the aircraft coming from the wing, fuselage, and all that must all balance. If MCG is equal to zero, the aircraft is said to be trim, or all of the things. The weights and other things are important because you consume the fuel, and if the fuel consumption happens, the center of gravity can move. So that's one of the reasons you store the fuel in a out as close to the center of gravity as feasible for it to be able to ensure that when the fuel is consumed, there is no great moment in the center of gravity. Okay, we'll stop here, and if you have any questions before I go further, I'll take those questions. So are there any things which was not clear and you want me to explain again? Please let me know. We can go ahead and deal with the next part of it in some detail. So all the trim aspects, everything will be in detail. Okay, since I don't hear any comments or anything, let me go to the next session. So to continue with the trim itself, for it to be able to produce the required lift to offset the weight, right? So L has to be equal to W and D has to be equated by T. Now it has to move with a velocity V in order to generate the liquid lift. And the lift produced or the force produced depends on the square of the velocity. This forward motion results in a resistive force drag, and the drag has to be offset or taken care of by the negated by thrust being produced by the propulsive system. Okay, now lift and drag both depend on the square of the velocity. Now thrust is the, under the control of the pilot, that's the throttle setting. And depending on the propulsive system, it could change with velocity or not change with velocity. So in aircraft geometry, it has to be designed such that these four forces act at a reference point in such a manner that they cancel each other out. Okay, and of course, it's you can't put your aircraft geometry whichever way you want. For example, if it's a fighter aircraft, you can't hang the missiles at the horizontal tail if there is one, or put it in front of the nose. All of it, you have to ensure wherever aircraft geometry is being looked at, to ensure that they're all as close to the center of gravity as possible. And there is no movement of the CG. Of course, there is always movement of the CG because of the fuel consumption. You're only trying to minimize it, okay, by, let's say, storing the fuel as close to the original center of gravity. So when you consume the fuel, there is not much change moment, okay? As I mentioned earlier, in a static system, enough about the fulcrum are equal. In a dynamic system, that's not enough. We have to look at moments. The force balance alone is not enough. We have to look at the moment. So the main challenge in ensuring the equilibrium in aircraft is that the lift and drag depend on velocity square. Okay, and lift also depends on the angle of attack or the pitch angle. But that is linear, at least in the small angles of attack, it's linear. So if you change from 2 degrees angle of attack to 3 degrees, you can use the linear CL alpha curve to predict it. And velocity, of course, is it goes like the square of the velocity. The static stability characteristic of all the three axes largely determine the trimmability of an aircraft. We talked about trim earlier, but now we'll have to look at how effectively the aircraft can be trimmed. Okay, so actually, as we said earlier, there's a little bit of repetition here. Dynamic stability largely determines the characteristics of the transient motion from the equilibrium. So when there is a disturbance, the aircraft goes into a transient motion and it comes back to its equilibrium if it's stable, or it can stay in the transient motion for a long time if it is neutrally stable, or go into divergent and away from the trimmed flight if it's unstable. So the object of trimming is to ensure lift equal to weight and T is equal to D, or thrust equal to drag. Okay, weight is not something which is changing except for the fuel consumption. We can ignore that to large extent. And lift and drag are depend on the square of the velocity. Thrust is under the pilot's control. So if the aircraft is stable, it will be then in stay in equilibrium until it is disturbed. Okay, and disturbance could come from an external disturbance like gust or turbulence, or it could be coming from the pilot moving the control surfaces. So all the parameters change during the course of a typical flight. So the trim adjustments need to be made, right? When you're the aircraft, let's say the pilot reaches the cruise altitude, sets the heading and the velocity, he sets the trim, but continuously fuel is being consumed. So the weight is continuously reducing, and the lift which was set initially has to be continuously reduced, which is a difficult thing to do. So if the stability margin is fairly large, then the pilot needs to only touch the control surfaces infrequently, not very frequently. But since to a large extent, the aircraft is symmetric, meaning the left half and the right half are identical, except of course when some equipment on one side or the engine failure happens. So this symmetry ensures aerodynamic properties of the airframe and with longitudinal trimming. Okay, so when the pilot wants to trim, it is largely longitudinal control, basically the elevator, either the full horizontal tail or part of the movable part of the horizontal tail, which is the elevator. So we'll be primarily concerned with moments about the pitch axis passing through the center of gravity. Weight of an aircraft does not contribute any moment, because that's how you define the center of gravity, as a point at which the moment because of the weight or the gravitational effects are zero. So weight doesn't, except of course if the weight changes far away from the center of gravity. That's why you keep all the fuel, which is the only thing which is being expended in the aircraft, as close to the center of gravity as possible. So most large aircraft, the fuel is stored in the wings itself, and the wing is fixed close to the center of gravity. So since the gravitational moments about center of gravity are zero, we need to compute moments contributed by the aerodynamic forces coming from the wing, fuselage, and tail. And they must all balance out. Essentially, we are looking at the summation of all the moments about center of gravity, all the moments about all the axes. Since it's symmetric, initially we'll confine ourselves to the pitch axis. And if that is equal to zero, then the aircraft is trimmed. So now let's look at a standard aircraft. Now this is a picture from NASA's Glenn Center. So here you see the weight, center of gravity is the yellow circle here, and the force is from the wing. Wing lift force is written as W. I normally write it as L suffix W and L suffix T. They have written as W as wing lift and T as the tail lift. And tail lift, you can see, is downwards. Because if the center of gravity is the yellow circle as seen here and W is acting behind, there is a nose down moment. Okay, and to balance that, I need to produce a force T downwards here to balance that. So how do I balance this? So W into the distance D suffix W should be equal to T into D suffix T. So larger the distance of where the wing lift is acting from behind the center of gravity, larger should be the tail lift downwards. Okay, and since this lift is downwards, it is reducing my overall lift, and so I have to fly faster to be able to balance the weight of the aircraft. So this part of, you know, the tail producing a negative lift, and that being means that I have to, the aircraft has to fly a little faster to be able to balance the weight, is usually referred to as the trim penalty. This is the, because the moment any object is a lift force in whatever direction, the drag is always in the same direction. So the larger the T I have to produce to balance the aircraft, larger is the tail drag, and that is called the penalty. the drag, because of the act of trimming, the drag you have to incur or encounter because of trimming is called the trim penalty. Okay, so just remember this: when I say describe the trim penalty, it's the drag produced by the control surface when you're trimming the aircraft. And if the, you can see from this figure, larger the distance, that is larger the D suffix D, W, then larger should be the T to balance out this equation on the bottom. So W into D suffix W plus T into D T should be equal to zero. Okay. And the D suffix W is usually referred to as the stability margin. How far is the distance between the center of pressure where the lift acts and the center of gravity where the weight is supposed to act. So for stability, all that is necessary, if an aircraft pitches nose up, then the resulting incremental aerodynamic moment about the center of gravity, let's say this delta MCG, should be negative in order to push the nose down again. So if that is possible, then the aircraft is stable. Or if the nose pitches down, the resulting moment should be nose up or positive. So this is what is called the stability in the longitudinal dynamics. Okay, so the resulting moment should restore the aircraft back to its equilibrium, which means that if the angle increases, okay, and the moment should be downwards. If the angle reduces, the moment should be upwards. Essentially, this says that delta MCG by delta alpha, meaning the rate of change of moment with respect to alpha, must be negative. Okay, so for today, I'll stop here. I'll continue here. Basically, since we started this class earlier than the scheduled university scheduled time, almost all the subjects and all the teachers are ahead of in the syllabus, so there is no worry. I'll stop here and I'll continue further. And most probably I'll finish all the syllabus by end of December or by first week of Jan. So there is enough time for revision, or if you have any other questions, we can have maybe more numericals. In this case, of course, numericals, the difficulty in numericals, if I take an actual problem of dynamics, then it becomes a huge issue. You'll have to do programming and all that. If I give a small problem, then it becomes almost like trivial. But anyway, we'll try and see what we can do. Okay, so I'll stop here. And if you have any questions, I will